Hi students, welcome to the class. So today we are going to start our chapter number 8, that is company audit part 2. In your initial chapter, chapter number 7, we have studied your all provisions in relation to the auditors, who can be auditor, qualification, disqualification of auditor, appointment of auditor, removal of auditor, resignation, audit report and so on. So all this portion we have covered in your chapter number 7, that is company audit part 1. So now in company audit part 2, basically we are going to learn the provisions in regard to the books of accounts, the entries made in the books of accounts, various accounts which are different in case of company. Which you cannot find in case of other entities. Like for example, share capital. It is not there in case of partnership firm. It is not in there in case of sole proprietorship. So different kind of accounts which are specially in case of companies, debentures, dividends, interest on debentures, various transactions like issue of shares, buyback of shares, redemption of preference shares. All these transactions are specially in case of a company. So in this chapter, we are going to learn the provisions in regard to audit of these items and what are the financial statements in case of a company, what they include. All these things we are going to read in this chapter. This chapter is purely your company law. So you need to understand your company law. All the provisions you have to understand. So that it will be very easy for you to understand all the questions and answers of this chapter. So let us start with your first question. What are the specific provisions regarding books of accounts in the Act? So in case of company, there are so many provisions. Even for books of accounts, there are provisions in Companies Act. So a company has to observe all these provisions for making their, for having the statutory requirements fulfilled. And the auditor has to check whether the company is fulfilling all the statutory requirements or not. So first thing is, however, from last Companies Act to this Companies Act, sections have changed. I already have communicated this thing to you. So please, I request you to not recall anything from your Companies Act 1956. First of all, the section has changed. It is now 128, section 128 for books of accounts. Now what the law says? Under section 128, the provisions in the matter of books of accounts are briefly summarized below. Contents of books. Obviously, it's a very genuine thing that you all must be knowing that. What all we have to record in the books of accounts? It's all about receipts and expenditures, sales, purchases, every expenditure, every receipt we have to record in the books of accounts. All the sales, all the purchases we have to record in books of accounts. Data regarding assets and liabilities has to be maintained. And if the central government has made it compulsory for a manufacturing company to maintain their cost records, then as per the guidelines issued by central government, costing records will also be maintained by the company separately. So, contents of books. Books of accounts should include records maintained in respect of the receipts and expenditure, the sales and purchases, assets and liabilities, the items of cost as may be prescribed under section 148 in case of a company which belongs to any class of companies which have been specified by the central government. Now, such books of account shall be kept on accrual basis. You must be knowing what is accrual basis. Accrual basis is not when cash is realized but as and when the transaction is due. And according to the double entry system of accounting, not single entry, it should be double entry. So this is the requirement regarding the books of accounts in our company Z. Then place of books, where the books are to be kept. The books of accounts should be kept at the registered office of the company. Registered office is the address of that particular branch of the company which is registered with the registrar of companies. So all the books of accounts has to be maintained at the registered office of the company. Books cannot be shifted from registered office to any other place. If the directors want to shift the books from registered office to some other place, maybe due to any reason, then they have to pass a board resolution and they have to send a copy of that resolution to the registrar within 7 days of passing the resolution. Only then they can shift the books from the registered office to some other location. The books of account and other relevant papers are required to be kept at the registered office of the company and no other place. Books of account for transactions effected at branch offices. Obviously, for branch office, the books are to be kept at the branch office only. Proper summarized returns periodically must be sent by branch office to the company, because branch obviously belongs to the company only. So, as the books of accounts of the branch are maintained at the branch itself, but the head office must be aware of all the transactions which are going on in the branch. So, what is the requirement now? A return specifying all the transactions, sales, purchases, expenses, receipts, details to the head office. So, branches have to submit a periodic return to the head office. Proper summarized returns periodically, maybe monthly, maybe bi-monthly, or maybe quarterly, not more than that, must be sent by branch office to the company at its registered office or other place as decided by the board of directors. Then change in location. Board of directors may decide to keep books at any other place in India. Company shall within 7 days of decision file with registrar a notice in writing giving full address of that other place. So you may underline the important terms like within 7 days of decision, file with registration means you can change location. It's not that you cannot change the location of the books, you can change. But whenever you pass a resolution to change the location of the books, within 7 days you have to file the copy with the registrar. Of that particular resolution, and then you can shift the books. Now electronic, this is a new provision introduced by Companies Act 2013, because in today's world, every company is following computerized information system, as I taught you in chapter number 4. So computerized information system is when all the information flow in an organization is through computers only. So now in this case, when physical books of accounts are not maintained, so if we have to keep the books of accounts at the place of the office, what will happen then? Do we need to print each and every account and keep it as a record? No. So now this provision has been introduced mainly because of the computers, dependence on computers, that when books of accounts are prepared in electronic mode, means in soft copy, then they have to preserve those books of accounts also in proper way, in the original format in which that was made, and not any alteration should be done in the accounts. So what are the provisions? Let us read in detail. The company may keep its books of accounts or other relevant papers in electronic mode. The books of account and other relevant books and papers maintained in electronic mode shall remain accessible in India, because this is the Companies Act which is applicable in India. So electronic mode, if your books of accounts are being maintained, then we need a copy in India also of those books of accounts. Then be retained completely in the original format, no change from the original format, no alteration. And information contained in electronic report shall remain complete and unaltered. Information received from branches shall not be altered. So the main thing is it has to be kept in the original form only. There shall be proper system for storage, retrieval, display or printout of electronic records, and they shall underline records shall not be disposed of unless permitted by law. So in original format we have to preserve everything, and they should be available for printouts, etc. It should not be that the electronic mode files are kept but we cannot retrieve or we cannot see the data. It should not be that. It should be always available for retrieval or printouts. Backup of books of accounts. Obviously, in case of soft copies, you must have a backup in the servers. Kept physically located in India on a periodic basis. Then, this is regarding the maintenance of books in electronic mode. So, if you are maintaining your books in electronic mode, there is additional requirement for information to be sent to the registrar also. So, company shall intimate to registrar on an annual basis during filing of financial statements, the name of the service provider, the internet protocol address. This is all as per the company's act. So, the internet protocol address of service provider, the location of service provider, and where books are maintained on cloud, such address as given by service provider. So this is all technical thing which we as a CA may not be able to provide the information to the registrar. So for this purpose, the IT person will provide the respective information and then the company will file it to the registrar. So this is a new provision regarding the books maintained in electronic mode. What is the new provision? That they have to be preserved in original format. The copy has to be preserved in India also. Copy in computer only, servers only. It has to be located in India also. And for branches also, it has to be kept in original format. It should be kept in such a way that it is available for retrieval or available to take up printout as and when required. Now, persons who can inspect, the books of accounts? Can the shareholders inspect the books of accounts? No. Although shareholders are the owners of the company, they have contributed share capital for commencement of the business of the company, but they are not at all entitled by law to open the books of accounts or to inspect the books of accounts. Apart from auditor, because I am the auditor, I have to audit the books of accounts. So the company cannot say that no, we will not provide you books of accounts. It is my right to ask for the books of accounts. So apart from auditor, who else can inspect the books of accounts? Obviously, the directors of the company have full right to inspect the books of accounts. Anytime during the business hours, they can go and inspect the books of accounts. Who else? Some other persons also are authorized by law. Books of accounts maintained within India shall be open for inspection by any director during the business hour. This is regarding the books maintained in India. Now, if the books are maintained outside India, then the directors can also ask for the information from those books of accounts, although there are certain provisions which the directors have to observe. Now, what are those provisions? For financial information maintained outside India, copies of such financial information shall be maintained and produced for inspection by any director subject to the following conditions. Summarized returns of books kept outside India shall be sent to the registered office at quarterly intervals. Just like in case of branches, the books which are kept outside India, a summary has to be sent to India in form of a return, which will be available to directors for inspection at any time during business hours. where any other financial information, if they require some other financial information apart from those return, then they can ask for that particular information, but then they have to give some time to get that information. Where any other financial information maintained outside India is required by a director, he shall furnish a request giving full details of such information, and its information shall be given to director within 15 days of receipt of request, and the request has to be sent by the director only and no other person. Inspection in respect of any subsidiary shall be done only by a person authorized by the board of directors. Of the employees have to support and provide all the information to that person. Now, period of maintenance. It's a good question. For how much period should we maintain the books of accounts? Can't we throw the books of accounts out after 1 year has elapsed? For last year, should I keep the books of accounts with me? The answer is yes, for continuous period of 8 years, we have to preserve the books of accounts. And if any case is going on, for example, income tax assessment or any other case, then the period may be more than that. The books of account together with relevant vouchers shall be kept in order by company for a minimum period of 8 financial years immediately preceding a financial year. And who is responsible for maintenance? The following persons are responsible for maintenance of books of accounts. They are the managing director, whole time director in charge of finance, CFO. These are the persons who are responsible, or any other person whom the board of directors have made responsible for preserving and maintaining the books of accounts. It is not the bookkeeper or the record keeper who has to maintain the books of accounts. It is the duty of the CFO, the whole-time director, the managing director of the companies to ensure that the books of accounts are kept in a proper condition for a period of 8 years. So, when after being CA, you join any office and you are told that please go to the bookkeeping department and see whether the books are kept properly or not. So you should not say that this is not my job. This is also a part of your job. Because even if you are a senior financial officer of a company, even if you are a managing director, even if you are whole-time director of the company, you are required to ensure that the books are kept in a proper condition. This is also a part of our job, that we have to keep the books of accounts, we have to maintain the books of accounts in a proper condition. Right? So this was all regarding the books of accounts, your section number 128. For this chapter, I have not made any summary of the sections. So, on the same format which I have given you for chapter 7, you can make summary of sections in this chapter also. Chaliye. Now moving ahead, what are the provisions regarding financial statements in the Act? Now what are financial statements? Financial statements are simply, you will say, they are balance sheet, they are profit and loss account, cash flow statement and other explanatory notes which are attached to the balance sheet and profit and loss account. So this is all about the financial statement. Now let us see what the law has said about it. As per section 2, subsection 40, if you can learn, you should learn this section. It's not necessary otherwise. Financial statement in relation to a company includes a balance sheet which is at the end of the year, profit and loss account which is for the year, and if it is a non-profit company, it will not be a profit and loss account, it will be income and expenditure account. Cash flow statement. So now, as per Companies Act 2013, cash flow statement has been made mandatory for all the companies now. Initially it was that if AS3 says, then you have to make the cash flow statement, but now it is mandatory for all the companies except some one person company or small companies. So every company has to make its cash flow statement now as a part of the annual return. A statement of changes in equity if applicable. Equity has changed during the year, then a separate statement is required. And any explanatory note annexed to a forming part of financial statement. So this is called financial statements as per Companies Act 2013. Provided that financial statement of one person company, now this is a new concept which is introduced in your Companies Act 2013, there can be one person company also. Small company, dormant company. In case of these companies, cash flow statement is not required to be submitted. Otherwise, balance sheet and profit and loss account is compulsory for all the companies. These are called the financial statements. Now, how to make the financial statements? The financial statements shall give a true and fair view of the state of affairs of the company. So it has give a true and fair view. Now, what is true and fair view? You all know. We have read it in detail in your chapter number 1. Comply with accounting standards which are notified in the Companies Act only. So, all those accounting standards have to be complied with for making your financial statements. Now, a new Schedule 3 has been prescribed, which I already told you that you have to learn. Schedule 3 provisions in detail in your accounts paper, because according to the disclosure requirements of Schedule 3, you will have to modify your vouching and verification requirements. So you have to undergo a complete detailed study for your Schedule 3. I will give you a copy of Schedule 3 so that you can read it from there. So, in detail, you will be studying Schedule 3 in your accounts or company law. So, as per Schedule 3, the format has been given for balance sheet and profit and loss account. So, that format has to be followed. The items contained in financial statements shall be as per accounting standards. So you should always remember that the requirements given as per the Companies Act are the minimum requirements, and you have to see whether if any additional disclosure is required, you have to fulfill those disclosures also. The above provisions shall not apply to those companies for whom we have a separate special act, like insurance companies, banking companies, company engaged in the generation or supply of electricity for electricity supply companies. For these three kind of companies, we have separate act. So they have to follow their own act. So, this Companies Act does not apply to these companies or any other class of company which has been specially prescribed. Any other class of company for which a form of financial statement has been specified, they are not required to follow the Schedule 3 of the Companies Act. Then is presentation of financial statements. a most important part of the job of a CA. What we have to do is, one is we have to make the financial statements of a company when we are working as an employee of that particular company. When you will become CA, you will join any company. So initially you will be doing this thing only. If you are in MIS department, what you will be doing is you will be making the financial statements of the company, the balance sheet, the profit and loss account of the company. Will you be also disclosing all the information to the shareholders? No. Who will be presenting the financial statement in front of the shareholders in the annual general meeting? It is the board of directors only. They will be presenting the results of the company to the shareholders. So after making financial statements, you are also required to make the PowerPoint presentations showing as compared to last year sales have increased. You must have seen all these presentations in case of many companies. And if you are shareholder of any company, you must go and attend the AGM of that particular company to understand what all business is carried out in the AGM. So having practical exposure will be very useful for you in case of auditing. Because auditing is a subject which is the most practically oriented subject. In auditing, you must have general knowledge as regards how the transactions are being conducted in case of a company. So at every AGM, board of directors shall lay before the company the financial statements for the financial year. Now what is consolidated financial statements? When a company has subsidiaries, then they have to make a financial statement in which entire business is shown at a one place, and that is called consolidated financial statement. Consolidated financial statement includes the financial statements of all the subsidiaries, and consolidated financial statement also has to be presented at the AGM of the company. A company shall prepare a CFS. Don't use this shortcut in examination. I'm just using it here. CFS including all, underlined including all the subsidiaries in the same form and manner as that of its own. Same form, same format as of Schedule 3. Subsidiaries are also required to maintain their financial statements and make their financial statements in the same format. CFS shall also be underlined laid before the AGM. Company shall also attach with its financial statement a separate statement containing salient features of financial statements of its subsidiaries, where subsidiary includes associate company also and joint venture company also. Consolidation shall be made as per the provisions of the Schedule 3 and applicable accounting standards. Provisions applicable to preparation, adoption and audit of financial statements of holding company will also applicable to the CFS. This is a new provision, that is the CFS, consolidated financial statement. Now deviation from accounting standards. However, no one is allowed to deviate from the accounting standards. Every company, every person is making the books of accounts is required to follow the accounting standards. But if there is some circumstance in which you are not able to follow a particular accounting standard, then you have to explain why you deviated from the particular accounting standards, what was the reason for deviation and what is the effect of such deviation in your financial statements. If financial statements do not comply with accounting standards, company shall disclose in its financial statements the following: the deviation, underline deviation from accounting standards, underline reasons why you deviated from them, and the financial effects, if any, arising out of such deviation. Now, authentication of the financial statements. You must go to Google and search for annual report of any company. Reliance or Tata, any company's annual report you should search. Annual report is the financial statements which is to be given to the shareholders, and then you should see the balance sheet of that company, the profit and loss account, the explanatory notes. You must have a practical knowledge of how the balance sheet, P&L, etc. are being presented to the shareholders. What you will notice is, in your examinations, what you do is, you make a balance sheet, you make a P&L account, and that's finished. But practically, when after making the balance sheet and P&L account, the main thing is to get it signed from the directors. So we have to first of all understand who are those persons whose signatures are required over the annual accounts, over the financial statements. So it is the Companies Act which will prescribe that, authenticate that these are the persons who are authorized to sign a financial statement of a company. The financial statements, including CFS, if any, shall be approved by board and signed by, who will sign it? The chairperson of the company. If chairperson is there, the chairperson will sign. See how many signs will be there below your balance sheet and account. Chairperson, and if chairperson is not there, then two directors of the company, out of which one must be managing director. The first signature will be of the directors or chairperson. Chairperson of the company where he is authorized by the board, or by two directors out of which one shall be managing director, then is the CEO of the company, the chief executive officer, and thirdly is the company's secretary. So these three signatures will be there below your balance sheet and profit and loss account. After that, these persons first of all will approve that yes, these are the results of our company, and then the auditor will audit it, and finally the auditor will also sign below the balance sheet and P&L account that yes, the statements have been audited. The chairperson or directors, out of which one has to be managing director, then is the CEO and company secretary where he is appointed. For one person company, obviously only one person is there, so he will be the only director of that company. So director only will sign. Auditor's report has to be attached to every financial statement, and apart from the financial statements, auditor's report also has to be attached. Then with the auditor's report, director's report also has to be attached. So all these things will form part of the financial statement. So when an examination is all these have to be included with the financial statements, and this will be your annual return which has to be sent to the registrar. Everything will be presented in the AGM. So these are your financial statements. Moving ahead, auditor's report we have done in your last chapter. Financial statements you will cover in your accounts paper. Now comes the board's report. Now, what is board's report? The board of directors also are required to submit a report to the shareholders, because board is the only person who is responsible for managing the company. So the shareholders want to ensure that they are doing their job perfectly. So the Companies Act require that board of directors also is required to submit a report to the shareholders over the affairs of the company during the last year, whatever has been conducted, any changes in the company's business, any new subsidiaries introduced, any subsidiaries who have been taken off, any mergers, acquisitions, any changes in technology of the business, forex transactions, certain transactions, the board of directors has to report whether accounting policies have been consistently followed, any big change, significant change in the accounting policy, whether the business is conducted on a going concern basis or not. So many requirements are there. So the shareholders also will want to know from the directors that whether they are doing their job perfectly or not. That's why a format has been introduced with the name of board's report, with the, which the board of directors are required to make and submit to the shareholders, including which includes your, which will be part of your financial statements. So the board's report is section 134, subsection 3 and 4. Now the board's report, what is the requirement? Shall be prepared based on stand-alone financial statements. If I am a holding company and I am having so many subsidiaries, so I must be making one financial statement of holding and financial statement of each subsidiary, and then one consolidated financial statement also I will be making. So the board's report, in the board report, I have to report only about the financial statement of the holding. And separately I will include the information regarding the financial statements of the subsidiaries. Board's report, the comment are to be made over the financial statements of the holding. Board's report shall be prepared based on stand-alone financial statements of the company. Stand-alone is only for the holding, and it shall contain a separate section wherein a report on performance and financial position of each subsidiaries, associate and joint ventures is presented. So separately in my board report I have to give information regarding the subsidiaries, and solely it has to be about the holding company only. So it shall be attached to statements laid before company in general meeting, and it shall include, now what all it has to include, what all the board's report must contain. First thing is the extract of the annual return, which is filed with the registrar. The number of meetings of the board, all these information I am required to supply to the shareholders of the company. Director's responsibility statement. What is director's responsibility statement? I am going to tell you later on as a next bullet. A statement on declaration given by independent directors. Now all these things are as per your company's Act 2013. So all these informations have to be included in board's report now. So we started with extract of annual return, underline number of meetings of board. All these informations has to be given to the shareholders. Third is director's responsibility statement. Fourth is declaration by independent directors. Those directors which are not at all related to the company, they are apart from full-time directors. So they also have to give a declaration in the director's report that we are independent. The declaration will be given as per the provisions of the Companies Act. Then in case of companies covered under section 178, subsection 1, so all these provisions have to be observed. Companies policy, so section 178, subsection 1, the separate committee has to be made for remuneration and appointment of directors. Just like audit committee is made, similarly, in case of certain companies, it is required by law that they have to make a separate committee for remuneration and appointment of directors. So in case of those companies, what they are required to include in the board's report, they are required to include the company's policy on directors' appointment, remuneration, including the criteria for determining qualification, positive attributes, independence of director and other matters. Just like you have read all the provisions regarding qualification, disqualification of auditor, on the same basis, qualification, disqualification, appointment, removal of directors also are there. You will be reading all these provisions in your CA final. So, these provisions, these things have to be included in the board's report. What next? Explanation or comments by board on every qualification made by auditor in his report and by company secretary in his secretarial audit report. So any qualification or reservation made by the auditor, the directors have to give the explanation on that particular qualification in the board's report. So if you have made as an auditor your audit report and you have included any qualification in your audit report, means you have made a qualified audit report. In that case, if you want to know the explanation of the directors, what you can do is, you can just check the board's report to know the reasons, the explanations, the comments of the board of directors. Then if loans, guarantees or investments particulars, contracts or arrangements with related parties. So if you want to know the related parties of any company, what you can do is, you can just read out the board's report of last year of the company. In that, all the details of related parties will be given. Then state of the company's affairs, how the business was conducted regarding the operations, everything has to be detailed of. The amount which is to be carried to the reserves. So if you want to audit, you can use board's report also. Then is amount which it recommends should be paid by way of dividend. The board of directors recommend dividend. Who pays it, who finally declares it, it is the shareholders. So if you want to know how much dividend was declared by the board of directors, you can simply see the board's report. Right? So material changes and commitments, which affects the financial position of the company, which have occurred between the end of financial year and the date of report. So that is the subsequent events. The detail of subsequent events will be given in the board's report. So everything you must understand. You have to learn all these points, all these provisions which are included in the board's report. Conservation of energy. Any steps during the year, if they have been taken by the directors of the company to conserve energy. Now what is energy? Energy is fuel consumption. Initially, we used to use so much of electricity for producing a particular unit of output. But currently, in this current year, we have reduced that electricity consumption. And that is called energy conservation. If fuel consumption have reduced, that is energy conservation. So all these things have to be given here. There is a separate form which is given under the Companies Act. So the directors have to fill that particular form. Technology absorption. If during the year any technology have been changed, and due to change in the technology, the production have improved or the costing have reduced. So that is called technology absorption. So all details of changes in technology which have resulted in something good, they have to be given in the board's report. They also separate from this technology absorption is there. Foreign exchange earnings and outgo as per the requirements of Companies Act. The detail of forex transactions also is required to be furnished in the board's report. Statement indicating development and implementation of a risk management policy. So how the board of directors are continuously assessing the risk, which in opinion of board may threaten the existence of company. If during the year the union members were on strike, so that is a risk factor. So all these informations, how the board continuously assess the risk if there is any change in technology in the market. How they are assessing that particular risk. This information also are required to be included in the board's report. And is policy developed and implemented on corporate social responsibility initiative. What is corporate social responsibility? Every company is required to serve to the society also apart from making the profits. For example, when I was working with Honda CL cars, when I was on visit of the plant once, what I saw was there was a pond, a small pond in the factory premises in which so many fishes were there. So I asked them that why this pond is made here. Can you think of any reason why a pond was there in which the fishes were there? So many fishes were there in that particular pond and the pond was in the office premises itself. The reason was they wanted to show that whatever water is wasted from the factory, it does not contain any chemicals to harm the animals, to harm the fishes. So they made a separate pond with that particular water which used to be wasted, and in that water the fishes were surviving. So this way they wanted to ensure that we are not polluting water because of our production. So that is called corporate social responsibility. They had a separate plant to treat that particular water so that that water is made useful for survival of the fishes. So that is called corporate social responsibility initiatives. If the company has built a pond to ensure that the water is not polluted and it can be used . Then this is a corporate social responsibility initiative and the board will mention it in their board's report. Or they have an NGO for any, say, for helping poor or for helping blind people, for helping people in education, for education, for saving girls, etc. So all these details will be given in the board's report. They all are regarding corporate social responsibility initiatives. Every company is required to serve to the society also apart from making profits. Then is every listed company and every other public company having a paid up of 25 crores or more calculated at the end of the preceding financial year. So what they have to do is a statement indicating the manner in which formal annual evaluation has been made by the underlying board of its own performance and that of its committees and individual directors. So these companies are required to annually evaluate the performance of the board and committees and they have to mention it in the board's report. Apart from that, the report of board shall also contain financial summary or highlights in which they will write, during the year our sales have increased so much, during the year our profits have increased so much. So this is the summary, the highlights. So highlights will be shown in the board's report. Changes in the nature of business, if any. Initially I was manufacturing mobile, now I have also started manufacturing iPads or iPods. So I will have to mention it in my board report of the company, if I am the director of the company, that we have changed a new line, we have introduced a new line of businesses. Details of directors or AMP who were appointed or who have resigned during the year. So all the details of directors and key managerial persons will be available in the board's report. Name of companies which have become or ceased to be subsidiaries. So all the related party disclosures also will be made in the director's report regarding the subsidiaries, joint ventures, associates. Details relating to deposits, like deposits accepted, unpaid, and any default in repayment of deposits or interest. So this detail also. So these are required as per the Companies Act. So directors have to mention it compulsorily in their board's report. Details of deposits which are not in compliance with the requirements of Chapter 5. So any non-compliance of law in relation to deposits has to be mentioned here. Details of significant and material orders passed by the regulators of court or tribunals impacting the going concern status and company's operations in future. This detail also will be maintained here, that any order which will affect the going concern of the company. Details in respect of adequacy of internal financial controls, whether the controls are appropriate, adequate or not. Now, board's report in case of OPC, one person company, in that case so much details will not be required. Simply, the most important thing which is required to mention in the board's report is all the comments and explanations over the qualifications given by auditors in there. So, in case of a one person company, board's report shall mean a report containing explanations or comments by the board on every qualification made by auditor in his. So, in case of one person company, this is the requirement from the board of directors. Now, what is director's responsibility statement? The directors also have a responsibility, and that responsibility is regarding the maintenance of the books of account, regarding the ensuring the going concern status of the company and so on, accounting policies, accounting estimates. It is directors only who have to select the best accounting policies to make the best judgments and estimates. So they have to give a responsibility statement specifying that they have made the best judgments as per the circumstances. So in preparation of annual accounts applicable, what the director's responsibility statement will include? It will include a statement made by the directors that in preparation of annual accounts, applicable accounting standards have been followed. And in case they have not been followed, what are the deviations and the reasons and effects of those deviations? This is to be given in the board's report. Then if the directors have selected, they will make a statement that we have selected such accounting policies and they have applied them consistently. They have made judgments and estimates that are reasonable and prudent so as to give a true and fair view of the state of affairs of the company at the end of financial year and of the profit and loss of the company for that particular period. Then is, directors had taken proper and sufficient care for underlying maintenance of adequate accounting records and safeguarding assets, preventing frauds. They have prepared annual accounts underlying on a going concern basis, and directors in case of a listed company have laid down underlying internal financial controls have also been observed to be followed by company and they are adequate and operating effectively. Directors have devised underlying proper systems to ensure compliance with all the applicable laws and they are adequate and operating effectively. So we have made a separate legal department also which ensures that all the legal provisions regarding companies have been fully complied with. So this everything has to be mentioned in the director's responsibility statement. So What we will include along with the financial statements is the board's report and the director's responsibility statement. In board's report, various informations in regard to the company and its subsidiaries and any changes in the business has to be included. The key managerial persons, the directors of the company, all this information will be a part of the board's report. Then a director responsibility statement also has to be attached, and that includes a declaration by the directors that yes, they have observed their duties to the maximum best possible way by including, by following all the accounting standards, by including best accounting estimates, accounting policies, by observing going concern and so on. So this declaration also is included as part of the board's report. So who will sign the board's report? Obviously, either the chairperson or two directors, out of which one has to be the managing director. These persons are required to sign the board report. The board's report and any annexes thereto shall be signed by its chairperson, if he is authorized by board, and if he is not so authorized, shall be signed by at least two directors, one of whom shall be a managing director, or by the director where there is only one director. This is all about the board's report. Okay, now let us move ahead. What are the provisions regarding powers of board of directors? So, board of directors have so many powers in case of a company. They are the managing heads of the company. They are the part of the top management of the company. They have to manage the entire company. So, many powers. Have been given to the board of directors, but however they must remember one thing, that whatever decision has to be taken by the company, by the shareholders in general meeting, board is not authorized to take those decisions. For taking those decisions, they have to take approval of the shareholders only. So apart from those things, there are certain powers which have been given to the board of directors. What are those powers? To make calls on the shareholders. They can make the call. They can decide that how much money they have to call for a particular call. To authorize buyback of shares, the directors can authorize. Issue securities, which includes debentures, etc. Borrow monies, directors can borrow money. Invest funds of the company, they can invest. To grant loans or give guarantee. To approve financial statement, obviously this is the right of the board of directors. To approve board report, to diversify the business, to approve amalgamation, merger, reconstruction, to take over a company, so all these decisions are taken by the board of directors. Apart from that, adopting accounts before submitting, that because they are the only ones who will sign over the financial statements, so they approve the financial statements. Appointing first auditors, which you read in chapter 7, and appointment in case of casual vacancy, investment in shares, entering into contracts with persons who are directors of the company, entering in contracts with the related parties. So all these decisions will be taken by the board of directors. So these are some of the powers, almost all the powers of the board of directors. So for exercising these powers, the board of directors will sit together, have a meeting, have a board meeting, and then they will pass a resolution in the board meeting to decide upon the powers which they can exercise. So these are all the decisions which can be taken by the board of directors by passing a resolution in the meeting of the board. Now moving ahead, we will now start the audit of the company. So one by one, starting from the memorandum, articles and prospectus. These are the initial documents of any company. So is an auditor required to have a look over memorandum, articles and prospectus? Should he? The answer is obviously yes, because memorandum contains all the information regarding the company, what is the capital, what is the liability clause, etc. With the help of memorandum, the auditor will be able to understand what are the powers of a company, what are the transactions which are ultra vires, what are the transactions which are intra vires. So for having a knowledge of all these things, auditor must read the memorandum of association, which is the charter of a company. Then comes the articles of association, which contains all the information regarding the internal rules and regulations of the company, rules, regulations regarding the management, what is the salary of the director, what is the remuneration of the director, what all things the directors are authorized to do, and so on. So for understanding, having an understanding about the internal management of the company, the auditor must also read the articles of association of the company. So whenever you are going for an audit of a company, you will first of all ask from the company to give you a copy of memorandum of association, a copy of articles of association, and then if the company has made an issue of shares during the year and it is a public company, then in that case it must have issued a prospectus to the public. So you want a copy of the prospectus also. Why? Because in that particular prospectus it will be mentioned that why the funds were raised and where these particular funds will be used. So an auditor has to ensure that the funds raised from a particular issue has been used only for that particular purpose which was mentioned in the prospectus. Otherwise what will happen is, if I am a shareholder of the company and it was mentioned in the prospectus that the company is going to open a new thermal plant, and this entire money will be used for that particular thermal plant, and the thermal plant will be operated it will be operational in 2-3 years. Now, even after contributing money for that particular project, after 5 years also the thermal plant is not in operation. Now what will happen is, I as a shareholder will definitely not like to give my money for such a purpose. What will I say is, please refund my money. So the auditor will have to ensure that whatever is mentioned in the prospectus, the money is used for that purpose only. If not, the shareholders can claim a refund of their money. And also regarding the underwriting contracts, commission paid to the underwriters, brokerage, etc., all these details will be given in the prospectus. So for this purpose, an auditor will start his audit by the study of memorandum, articles and prospectus. So let us read from your notes. Memorandum of Association. It is a charter containing all the rules, particulars of business activities that the company can undertake and the powers it can exercise. On examining MOA, auditor will be able to determine whether a transaction entered into by a company is intra vires, means within the powers of the company. If a company enters into ultra vires transaction, shareholders, though entitled to claim profit arising on such a transaction, may restrain management from charging loss. If auditor fails to detect and report ultra vires transactions, he would be guilty of negligence. So, memorandum of association and auditor must have from the company. Then is articles. These are rules and regulations for internal management of the company. Underline internal management. I know you must be knowing about articles of association, and in detail you will be reading this in your company law. These are rules and regulations for internal management of company. Auditor should therefore study articles and include extracts from them in his permanent audit file. What is permanent audit file? but it's not carried daily to the office, and it contains the records which do not keep on changing. We did it in chapter number 3, if you remember. So, auditor who fails to take note of provisions in articles in verification of statements of accounts would be guilty of professional negligence. He must acquaint himself with provision of articles and should apply this knowledge in verification of transactions. Because in many of the transactions, it will be written that the auditor has to see if articles mention this or not, articles mention this or not. So if it is mentioned in the articles, only then the company is authorized to do a particular thing. For example, buyback of shares has to be authorized by the articles also. So these are the rules for internal management of the company. Then is prospectus. What is prospectus? It is a document which a public company must issue before it makes allotment of shares. It must contain all terms and conditions on which subscription to shares is sought to be obtained from public. In case the company fails to carry out any of these undertakings, or if any statement made by it ultimately is proven to be false, the shareholder has the option to claim refund of the amount paid by him. So auditor should study carefully all stipulations made in the prospectus, and in case any of them has not been carried out, to draw the attention of shareholders thereto. Right to claim refund is restricted to such shareholders who subscribe for shares on the basis of profits. So, how the company will start? It will start with the memorandum, articles and prospectus. So, auditor must get a copy of memorandum, articles and prospectus from the company and have a detailed knowledge of these things so as to understand which are ultra-virus transactions, what are the rules and regulations for internal management of the company, and how the money has to be used which has been raised by the public issue. These are the three main important documents which an auditor has to obtain from the company. First and foremost item which is included in the balance sheet of a company is what? Share capital. So, an auditor has to start this audit with the audit of share capital. So, how the auditor will start? How an auditor will audit the share capital? What all is included in the share capital? The first thing is authorized capital. What is authorized share capital? The total share capital which a company can raise is authorized share capital, which it can ask the shareholders to pay. This thing you can check from the memorandum of association, from the capital clause of MOA. Authorized capital will be mentioned over there. And if the company has not issued any further share capital, then from last year's financial statement also you can check the amount of the authorized share capital. Right? So audit of share capital, you are not only required to audit the share capital during the issue of shares, but also during starting of the business, every year you have to audit the share capital also. If there is any change in the amount of shares issued or subscribed, then also you have to audit some additional points during the audit of the share capital. So first thing is authorized capital. It may be verified with reference to amount shown in the MOA or previous year audited balance sheet may be seen. Then is issued and subscribed share capital, which can be verified with the help of the last year balance sheet also. Then is further issue of capital. If during the year the company has issued further capital, so it must have sent and issued a prospectus first to invite money from the public. So you will get the prospectus. The general points are given as under. So how the money is issued, how the capital is issued. For that, the company will issue a public offer with the help of the prospectus. First of all, auditor will see what is the authorized share capital, and after the issue of share capital, the limit should not exceed. Then all the rules and regulations as per the AOA, and he will also see the prospectus. So study conditions of issue from MOA, AOA, prospectus, and see that all of them have been fully complied with. Then there is a clause that minimum subscription has to be received before any allotment of shares has been made. Till the minimum subscription is received, the money will be kept in a separate bank account which has to be opened with a scheduled bank. So all these provisions an auditor has to observe. Then all the contract with the underwriters also have to be seen, how the payment is to be made to the underwriter. Then all the preliminary expenses also have to be shown in the balance sheet. So proper accounting is done or not, all these things an auditor will have to observe. So verify that first allotment was made on receiving amount of minimum subscription stated in prospectus, and until then amount received was deposited in a scheduled bank as per the provisions of Companies Act. Confirm that brokerage and underwriting commission was paid only at the rate which was authorized in prospectus or AOA. Ensure that legal requirements, if it is right shares, then legal requirements also have to be complied with. If it is sweat equity shares, accordingly all the compliances have to be checked. Verify that preliminary contracts, if any, entered into for purchase of property, etc., have been carried out strictly as per the terms stated in prospectus. If the money was raised for purchasing of a property, then accordingly we will see that as per the terms and conditions stated in the prospectus, all things have been observed. Ensure that company intending to offer shares to public by issue of prospectus has, before such issue made, an application to one or more recognized stock exchange for permission to offer shares. Each stock exchange. So if the company wants that the shares should be sold and purchased on the stock exchange, then it has to get it registered over that particular stock exchange. SEBI ki guidelines bhi follow karni hai. So the company will have to follow the guidelines issued by the Stock Exchange Board of India. Checks have to be seen whether proper control is there over the money received from the shareholders. Verify compliance in regard to the provisions for shares issued on premium, shares on discount, and so on. So these are the general provisions in case of further issue of share capital. Now, what if the shares are issued for cash? If the shares are issued for cash, then the shareholders will be required to pay the money for the shares they have got. So it can be either for cash or it can be other than cash. Or we can call it in kind. First of all, you will invite application from the shareholders. When you receive the minimum subscription, then you will make an allotment. At the time of allotment, everyone will not be given the shares. Some will be given the letter of regret to refuse any shares to them, and some will be given the letter of allotment of the shares. So board of directors will decide how the allotment of shares have to be made. And after allotment, the entry will be made in the share register of the company, where it will be entered that these are the shareholders of the company. And then, if further calls are made, the call register will be there. This also board of directors will decide how much money should be called. All the details regarding calls in area and calls in advance. You can get from the calls register. And if a person is not making the paying the money on time, the share, the directors will forfeit the shares. This is the entire process. First of all, application will be invited from shareholders. Minimum subscription when received, allotment will be made. Some will be given the shares, some will be refused. The refusal will be with the help of letter of regret, and allotment will be with the help of letter of allotment. And then the entry will be made in the share register, where the detail of the members will be given. And then after that, whenever the board of directors decide to make a call, they will make an entry in the calls register, which will contain detail of all the calls in arrear and calls in advance. And if a call in arrear is for a long period of time, then the directors, if authorized by articles of association, may go for forfeiture of shares. So what all books of accounts are being maintained here? Cash book will be there. Here, application and allotment book will be there. This entry is also made in application and allotment book. Then is the share register. So all these books, a share auditor is required to check. Share register and calls register. Apart from that, because the board of directors are making all these decisions, so minute book of board, which will contain detail of board's resolution. So these all things will be available to the auditor, which an auditor will have to check. Which an auditor will have to audit for issue of the share capital. And if the shares are issued other than cash, that is in kind, maybe for purchasing the machinery, etc., then there will be a contract with that particular person to whom we are issuing shares in place of cash. So the auditor will review a copy of that contract in case of order of issue of shares other than cash. Let us start. Shares issued for cash. It can be, first of all, you make a note of all these things. So if you have this flowchart, it will be easy for you to explain everything in your examinations regarding the issue of share capital. So let us start from the notes. Shares issued for cash. Applications. First of all, it is applications. It can be verified in the following manner. Check entries in application and allotment book with the original applications which have been received by the company. So this entire process you must have read in your accounts also. In accounts, you must have read about the journal entries which we pass on receiving the application money, on making the allotment and so on. pro rata basis allotment is made. So in accounts you must have read it in detail regarding the application, allotment, calls, calls in advance, calls in arrear, forfeiture of shares. So you must be aware of all these terms. Chaliye, issue of share on cash. It is becoming little bit theory only. So if you will relate it with your accounts, it will be easy for you to understand. This chapter is basically theory only. And whenever we talk of law, law includes provisions, and provisions make everything go in. So, but you have to learn it to clear your examinations. Stop thinking what is boring, what is interesting. Theory subjects or practical subjects, anything will be boring for you if you feel so. If you feel that it is important for you to clear the examination, then instead of thinking whether it is boring or not, you will be thinking whether it is important or not. So it can be verified in the following manner. Check entries in application and allotment book with the original applications. Trace entries for money received in application and allotment book with the cash book. Vouch amounts refunded to the unsuccessful applicants with the copies of letters of regret. Check total in application and allotment book and see whether the journal entry is correctly made in the books of accounts. Then is underwriting contract, which we have to see to ensure that payment has been made to the underwriters and how the payments have been made, what was the underwriting commission, etc., whether it has been made as per the underwriting contract or not. So many points which you can yourself make instead of mugging up all these points. It's basically the process which you have to audit in case of a audit of issue of share capital. Underwriting contract to ensure that all obligations have been fully satisfied. What is underwriting contract? The underwriters agree to the minimum subscription if it is not achieved by a company. Vouch payment of commission and brokerage. So this was about the application. Now moving on to allotment of shares. Who will allot the shares? It is the board of directors who will decide how to make the allotment. If the application is almost the number of applications received are almost the same for which we made the issue, then shares will be allotted to all the applicants. But if applications have been received in a higher quantity, for example, I issued 1 lakh shares of the company, but the application have been received for 5 lakh, from 5 lakh persons. So I cannot make allotment to 5 lakh persons. What I will do is, I have to think about how to make the allotment. Now, in case of making the allotment, there is preferential allotment also. What is preferential allotment? For some persons, we will have to make the allotment, for example, promoters of the company. That is a preferential allotment. So in case preferential allotment is made, I have to ensure that the price collected from those persons for whom preferential allotment is made, it is the same price which is collected from others. So after preferential allotment, the board of directors may decide to issue shares on a pro rata basis. So pricing in case of preferential allotment also has to be checked. Right? So examine directors' minutes books to get the resolution, board's resolution in which the decision was made regarding allotment of shares. Then is ascertained that nominal value of shares allotted does not exceed authorized and issued capital, obviously. And the allotment was made as per the prospectus. One more document which you should include is prospectus in case of public company. So how many documents you have now? 7. Compare copies of letter of allotment with entries in application and allotment book. Trace entries for amounts collected in cash book and application and allotment book. Trace amount collected into share register. Then you have to check arithmetical accuracy. These are the common things which you have to do. Arithmetical accuracy, accounting entry. Then allotment return has to be filed with the registrar because you have changed your memorandum of association also. Now you have changed your capital also. Not memorandum, you have changed your authorized capital also. So whenever any changes are made in the capital portion of the balance sheet, you have to inform the registrar also. So a return has to be filed with the registrar. for issue of the share capital. That is a new provision. Check that amount payable on application on every security is not less than 5% of the nominal amount of security of such other percentage or amount as may be prescribed by SEBI. Now, if I have issued a share whose par value or nominal value is 100 rupees, so Companies Act has said that application money should not be less than 5% of the nominal value, means not less than rupees 5 in this case. If it is 1000, then it should be 50. So application cannot be called for less than 5% or any other percentage which has been specified by SEBI. So if my share value is rupees 100, par value 100, then I cannot call less than rupees 5. I must call 5 rupees or more than that. So check that amount payable on application on every security is not less than 5%, underline 5% of the nominal amount of security. If the stated minimum amount has not been subscribed, means minimum subscription has not been received, and sum payable on subscription is not received within a period of 30 days from date of issue of prospectus or such period which may be prescribed by SEBI, check that the amount received is returned within a period of 15 days from closure of issue, and in case of default to repay, the lenders in default shall jointly and severally is liable to repay that amount with interest at the rate of 15% per annum. I issued prospectus. Within 30 days, I was not able to collect the minimum subscription. Then, within next 15 days, what I have to do is, I have to return the entire money which I have collected, which was below minimum subscription. If I am not able to repay the entire money because of the reasons that minimum subscription was not received, then I will have to repay the money back with an interest amount that will be 15% per annum. Then see that company has delivered share certificates. Share certificates has to be given to the shareholders after letter of allotment. The next thing is share certificates. Then, signatories to MOA being the first shareholder, it is usual to make allotment in their favor. You can write it here, that is preferential allotment. So, for preferential allotment, you will also have to see to whom preferential allotment has been made. They are the promoters, generally the promoters of the company. Promoters mean those persons who have signed the memorandum of association, who have floated that particular company. They are the promoters of the company. So, preferential allotment can be made to those persons. And how many shares have been given to them, what is the price of those shares and so on, I will have to check. This was all regarding the allotment of shares. Then is the calls. How I will audit the calls. Examine director's resolution on making call. They will decide how much money I have to call on shares. Then vouch amounts received. I have to trace the cash book. Entries has been correctly made in the cash book. And entries have been correctly made in the share register, where I will enter in front of every shareholder that this is the amount collected from such shareholder. Then the accounting entry I have to check, general point. If there is any calls in area, I have to check. And if the calls in area is from directors, then it has to be shown separately. This also I have to see. Then is shares issued for consideration other than cash. We have to refer the contract on the basis of which shares have been allotted. Allotment is to be made by the board of directors. So the next thing is the minutes of the meeting of the board of directors. Confirm the allotment by reference to minutes of the board of directors. Verify that a copy of contract has been filed with ROC. This is the legal requirement within 1 month of date of allotment. Appropriate accounting entry should be made. Shares issued for consideration other than cash has to be shown separately in the balance sheet. And if allotment is made, now this is a new provision, in adjustment of a bona fide debt payable in money at once, allotment should be considered as against cash. If payment has to be made fully at once in cash, then I will consider it as a shares issued against cash. Means, other than cash, I have given the shares as an adjustment. For example, I got a loan from some person and now I don't have enough cash to pay back my loan. What I have done is, instead of paying my loan in cash, I have asked that person that I will not pay you cash 1 lakh rupees, I will straight away give you shares worth rupees 1 lakh rupees. So that will be treated as shares issued for cash only and not other than cash. Right? Because I have not purchased anything for those shares which are issued other than cash. I have just used those shares for repaying my loan at once. So it will be considered as cash issued. This is a new point. Shares issued at a premium. What is premium? When the par value of the share was 100 rupees, but I have issued it for rupees 110. So this additional 10 rupees is my premium. So shares can be issued for premium also. But when this 10 extra rupees collected from the shareholders, it will not be a part of the authorized share capital or issued share capital. It will be separately shown in the balance sheet under the heading securities premium account. And the money which is collected in this way has specific uses only. It can be used only for the purposes which are being specified under the Companies Act. So the new section, section 52, regarding the shares issued at a premium. Sum equal to the amount of premium collected should be transferred to the securities premium account, underlying securities premium. There is no shares premium account as of now, it's only securities premium account. Where this money can be used? For issuing fully paid up bonus shares, for writing of the preliminary expenses, for writing of any expenses relating to issue of shares or debentures, for paying premium on redemption of redeemable preference shares or debentures. So share this money, premium money can be used only for these specific purposes. For the purchase of its own share or other securities under section 68, that is buyback of shares. So I have to see as an auditor whether first of all appropriate disclosures have been made in the balance sheet as regards to securities premiums. Then second thing, if during the year any amount has been used from the securities premium account, how and where that amount has been used means it can be used only for these specified purposes which has been prescribed under section 52. So as an auditor, I will first of all see whether proper accounting entry is made in the books, whether proper disclosure is made in the balance sheet as regards the securities premium, and if during the year there is any change in the securities premium account, the amount has been used, where the amount has been used, whether it was used for the purposes which have been specified or not. So this was all regarding the shares issued at premium. Moving ahead, shares issued at discount. So for your information, I must tell you that as of now, the Companies Act has not allowed any company to issue shares at discount now. So as per Companies Act 2013, no company is authorized to issue shares at discount. So remember this. There is no provision for shares issued at discount. Why? Because now the shares cannot be issued at discount. Discount was, initially it was, if it is 100 rupees, the company may issue shares at 90 rupees. That was called discount. But now, if the par value of the share is 100 rupees, company cannot issue the shares below that value. So no shares can be issued at discount. However, shares can be issued as sweat equity shares. That is, next point. As per section 53, a company cannot issue shares at discount. Underline cannot, circle cannot. Except in case of sweat equity shares under section 54, any share issued by a company at a discounted price shall be void. So no company is allowed to issue shares at discount now. If a company contravenes the provisions of this section, it shall be punishable with fine ranging from 1 lakh to 5 lakh rupees. So, if a company issues shares at discount, it will be charged a penalty. So, better not to issue the shares at discount. Now, issue of certificate issuers. What is certificate? Your section 54, this is a new section for certificate issuers. What is certificate issuers? Which is issued to the employees of the company in return for the sweat they have given to the company. Means anything which they have added to the company may reward them in form of giving them the equity shares. So in this case only the company can either issue the equity shares without asking for anything from the employees, or the company may issue equity shares at a discount to the employees of the company. Cert equity shares means equity shares issued by the company to employees or directors at a discount or for consideration other than cash for providing know-how or making available right in the nature of intellectual property rights or value additions by whatever name called. So if you have contributed something to the company apart from what you were required to give, and because of your contribution, maybe because of your knowledge, because of anything you contributed to the company, the company has got profits, so the company will like to reward you in the form of giving you the shares of the company. So these shares will be called as cert equity shares. So there are certain provisions in regard to cert equity shares also. So who will make the decision whether the cert equity shares are to be given? Obviously it is the directors of the company only. So for verifying the cert equity shares, the auditor will have to check the board's resolution first of all, authorizing the issue of cert equity shares, and then in that resolution all the detail will be given in regard to whom we are issuing it, at what price we are issuing it, what the reasons of issuing it, number of shareholders, the number of shares, the price of the shares, and so on. So the auditor will first of all ask for the resolution of the board of directors to check the issue of the cert equity shares. So auditor should see that cert equity shares issued are of a class of shares already issued. What do you mean by the class of shares? If it was initially the share capital of the company which has been already been raised is rupees 100 per share, then the cert equity shares should also be for rupees 100 only. The new class cannot be created by rupees 50. So the cert equity shares should be of the class of shares already issued. A new class cannot be created. Issue of cert equity shares has to be authorized by special resolution in general meeting, and resolution should specify the number of shares, current market price, consideration if any, and the class or classes of directors and employees to whom such equity shares are to be issued. So it has to be mentioned in the resolution that who is entitled to receive the cert equity shares. That is, check that at the date of issue at least 1 year has elapsed from the commencement. So only after 1 year of commencement. Of business, these shares can be issued. Obviously, this is logical also, because if the company had just started, before 1 year, how you can evaluate which employee is working good, which director is working good or not? So what you will do is, you will see that the company is in business for more than 1 year, then the shareholders will see that these are the employees or directors of the company who are contributing to a great extent for the promotion of the company. So the shareholders will decide in their general meeting to whom we are going to make the payment of these shares, to issue the cert equity shares. The cert equity shares of a company whose equity shares are listed, the shares are listed, you have to see the compliance of the SEBI also. So these are all provisions in regard to cert equity shares. They are issued by the shareholders of the company. The shareholders will decide to whom we are going to give the cert equity shares, either to the directors or the employees of the company. They will have to pass a special resolution in the general meeting, and in that resolution they will mention the entire detail in regard to whom they are being issued, what is the amount of shares, what is the quantity of shares. Everything will be mentioned over there, and these shares should be of the class which has already been issued. No new class can be created for the cert equity shares, and they can be issued either at discount or for the services they have provided to the company, and not before 1 year of commencement. So at least 1 year should have elapsed when the company has commenced its business. This is all about your cert equity shares. Now is calls paid in advance. What is false period in advance? I issued shares for a par value of rupees 100. The face value of share was rupees 100. On application, I called rupees 40. Now I am going to make first call. So it can be for rupees 10. I made a first call. Some shareholders were interested in making the entire payment, so they paid rupees 100. So what extra have they paid? Say I made a call for 20 rupees, but they made a payment of entire amount, that was 60 rupees. So they have made an advance payment. They have made of rupees 40. They paid 40 initially. I have called for 20 more. Means in total they will have to pay 60 rupees, including this call. The balance was 60, which I was to call. They said we will pay the entire balance. So they have paid an advance of rupees 40 more. This is called calls in advance. When the shareholders pays money in advance. Now, the first thing an auditor has to see is whether the company is authorized by its articles of association to collect the money in advance. If it is authorized by the articles of association, then only a company can collect funds in advance, otherwise not. So, if the company is authorized, it can collect the money in advance. Then, for this additional money paid, shareholders will not get any additional voting rights. Voting rights will be same. So, additional voting rights will not be there. However, if authorized by articles, the company may pay additional dividend on these calls in advance. And if there is no such provision in the articles in regard to paying dividend on calls in advance, then the company will have to pay interest on this money received in advance. It has to be shown separately in the balance sheet. Auditors should study AOA to ascertain the powers of company to accept from members the amount remaining unpaid on any shares. Amount can, so received cannot be treated as part of capital for purpose of any voting rights. No extra voting rights will be given for this call in advance. If company is authorized by articles, it may pay dividend in promotion to amount paid. Unless the company decides to pay dividend, the shareholders who have paid calls in advance will be entitled to receive interest at the rate specified in articles. And if the company is not in profits, then also the shareholders are entitled to receive the interest just in case of debentures. So company will have to pay the interest to the calls in advance, and at the time of winding up, this payment has to be made first and then the payment has to be made for share capital. In the event of winding up, calls in advance is paid with interest accrued thereon before any part of capital is returned to shareholders. This was all about the calls in advance. Now is calls in arrear. What is calls in arrear? Sometimes what happens is the company may call, just like in this case, application was of 40 rupees, directors made first call of rupees 20, but the shareholder pays only 0. So he has not paid 20 rupees till now. So this 20 is called an arrear which the shareholder has not yet paid. So the articles may also have provisions regarding calls in arrear, that if a person has not paid calls in arrear for a continuous period of 3 months, then we can forfeit his shares and so on. So the auditor will have to see the articles of association regarding the provisions for calls in arrear. Calls in arrear has to be again shown separately in the balance sheet, and if it is from directors, the directors have not paid the calls money, then it has to be shown separately, calls in arrear from directors. amount due from shareholder for calls in arrear has to be verified with reference to share register. Any calls due from directors should be shown separately in the balance sheet. And if articles provide, then the company can charge interest on these calls. Or if the articles provide, the company can forfeit these shares as per the process given in the articles. So if AOF provides to charge interest on calls in arrears, then interest in such a case should be. So this was all about the audit of share capital. Share capital means shares issued for cash, issued for other than cash. Then we included calls in advance and calls in arrear, sweat equity shares issued for premium, shares issued for discount. So all these things we will have to audit as an auditor. So this was all about issue of share capital. So let us move ahead with our buyback of shares. So in detail you must be studying buyback in your company law. All the provisions you must have studied or will be studying in your company law, in your law subject, and also in your accounts subject will be studying what are the accounting entries which are required to be made in case the company purchases its shares from the market. So now I'm going to just brush up those provisions from your company law. This is the new section which has been made for buyback of shares, and that is section 68. Under section 68, all the provisions in regard to buyback of shares are being made. Buyback means the company is listed on stock exchange and the company has issued its shares in the market. Now the company wants to purchase those shares back from the shareholders. So what the company will do is, company will pay the money to the shareholders, and in return the share certificates will be returned to the company. So in that case, what will happen is the issued capital will be reduced, the share capital will be reduced. So accounting entry and all you will learn in accounts. Let us read all the provisions, when a company can make buyback of shares and what are all the provisions in regard to buyback. So as per section 68, so what amounts can be used from where the company can buy the shares back from the market? Company may buy back its own shares and securities out of the free reserves, that is the profit available for distribution to shareholders. Company can use those free reserves to buy back the shares, or securities premium account, or the proceeds of the issue of any shares or other specified securities. The company just now issued some shares, and the company can use that particular money to buy back its shares. But it has been specifically mentioned that no buyback shall be made out of the proceeds of an earlier issue of same kind of shares or securities. Now why this provision has been made? They say that if you have issued shares, then you cannot use that particular money to buy back those shares only. Why this provision has been made? For example, I issued share for rupees 100. I called rupees 100 from the shareholders. And now what has happened in the market, that the market has crashed and the market price of my share is now 80 rupees. So I cannot use this money to buy back these shares. Otherwise, I will make a profit of rupees 20. And the companies will start doing this thing only. They will issue shares for 100. Then when the market value is down, they will use this money only to buy back this particular share. So they will make a profit. So it has been specifically mentioned in the law that for buyback of shares, if you are using money from issue of certain shares, then that money cannot be used if it is of the same class of shares which has already been issued. So some other class of shares you can use. These 50 shares were also there. So the money collected from these shares you can use to purchase these shares. Not the same class of shares. The proceeds of the issue of any shares or other preferred securities, no buyback shall be made out of the proceeds of an earlier issue of same kind of shares or securities. So that the companies do not intend into this practice. So this provision has been made for buyback of shares. Now, what are the conditions a company has to observe before making buyback of shares? The buyback should be authorized by articles. Special resolution has to be made in the meeting of the shareholders. However, if the buyback is 10% or less of the paid up capital and reserves, then the board of directors can authorize this buyback. A special resolution has been passed in general meeting authorizing the buyback. However, in case buyback is up to 10% of paid up capital and free reserves, this is a new provision, it may be done only with authorization of board resolution. So for that purpose, special resolution need not be made. But if it is more than 10% of paid up capital and reserves, then special resolution has to be passed in the meeting of the shareholders. Buyback is not more than 25%. This is the legal provision you have to observe, that not more than 25% of paid-up capital and reserves can be bought back from the market. Now, ratio of debt owed by company after such buyback should not be more than twice the total of its paid-up capital and its reserves. Means the debt equity ratio should not be more than 2:1 after buyback. Debts after this should be not be more than this. Debt should be twice only of the equity. Right? So 2:1 ratio has to be observed for the debt equity ratio after buyback. All the shares have to be fully paid up. Only the fully paid up shares can be bought back. If the share was for 100 rupees, it should be fully paid up, though then only I can buy back that particular share. Then it has to be authorized by SEBI. Sorry, all the provisions prescribed by SEBI has also to be followed. There cannot be more than one buyback in a year. In 1 year, only one buyback can be there. It has to be completed. Now this detail has to be given in balance sheet also, in financial statements also. The company is required to furnish this detail that whether it completed the buyback on time or not. So within 12 months of the resolution being passed in the board's meeting or in the shareholders meeting, within 12 months buyback has to be completed. So every buyback shall be underlined completed within 12 months from date of passing special resolution or resolution passed by board of directors. When board of directors will pass the resolution? When the buyback is 10% or less than 10% of paid up capital and reserves. Notice of meeting at which special resolution is proposed to be passed shall contain full details of buyback. So in the notice of the meeting itself, we have to specify that we are going to buy back the shares. So for this purpose, we are going to pass a special resolution in the meeting of the shareholders. So all shareholders must be aware of it. The buyback may be from existing security holders on a proportionate basis. We can ask from the shareholders who are existing in the market, or we can straight away go to the open market and ask all the persons to give back their shares, or by purchasing securities issued to employees under employee stock option scheme. So if we have given some securities to the employees, we can ask them that we are going to purchase backed securities from you. So it can be either way. Company shall before making buyback. So approval of registrar is also required. File with registrar and SEBI a declaration of solvency. We have to file a declaration that after we buy back our shares, we will be solvent. We will not become insolvent. Why? Because the equity has decreased after buyback. So we will remain solvent even after the buyback. The company shall before making buyback file with registrar and SEBI a declaration of solvency stating that it is capable of meeting its liabilities and will not be rendered insolvent within a period of 1 year of the date of declaration. Why this declaration has to be made? Because after buyback of shares, the equity will decrease. So the company has to ensure that they have sufficient funds to pay off their liabilities within 1 year. Means short-term liabilities at least they will be able to pay after the buyback of shares. The company then after buying back the shares, the shareholders will give back the share certificates. The company will destroy those share certificates within 7 days of completion of buyback. A separate register has to be made in which all the details regarding the buyback will be made. Company shall not make further issue of same kind of shares within a period of 6 months. So after buyback is completed, for next 6 months, same shares cannot be reissued in the market. Only for bonus issue you can use these shares. If company purchases its own shares out of free reserves, if free reserves or securities premium is used for buying back own shares, then it is a requirement that a separate account has to be created by the name of Capital Redemption Reserve Account. A sum equal to nominal value of shares purchased shall be transferred to CRR account and such details are enclosed in the balance sheet. CRR can be used only to issue bonus shares. These are all legal provisions which you have to learn. After buyback, the company has to maintain a register of securities. So what consideration paid for them when the securities were cancelled, when the certificates were destroyed, and any other particulars which a company is required to make. So all these details will be paid by the company in a separate register. After buyback, the company shall file with the registrar and SEBI a return has to be filed. Why? Because the capital has changed now. So return has to be filed within 30 days and auditor will check whether accounting entries are proper or not. So what is required from an auditor? First thing is he has to see whether all the legal provisions has been observed or not. And second thing what he has to see is whether accounting entry is accurate or not. So for legal provisions you have to read the entire section 68 from where the money can be used, who is authorized to ensure to make the buyback, how the buyback can be made, what all documents can be used for audit of the buyback of the shares. So all these provisions an auditor has to understand. He has to see whether all these provisions have been observed by the company or not. So that is why we say that auditor must have knowledge of law also. Why? Because he has to ensure that statutory compliances have been made by the company or not. Because he has to include this in his report. Audit report that all the statutory requirements have been fulfilled. The prohibition for buyback in certain circumstances. So for buying back the shares, certain provisions are there. As per provisions of section 17, no company shall directly or indirectly purchase its own shares or other specified securities through the subsidiaries of the company. I cannot ask my subsidiary that you go and buy back my shares. No. With the help of subsidiary, we cannot buy back our shares through any investment company or if a default by the company, if the company is a defaulter, he has not made payment of the deposits, he has not repaid the deposits, he has not paid the interest on these deposits, it has not redeemed the debentures of preference shares, then we cannot use money to buy back our own securities. So first of all, we have to make payment to all of them and after the payment has, if I have defaulted in making the payment to these persons, then first of all what I have to do is, I have to remove this default and I have to remedy this default and a period of 3 years should have been elapsed. Only then I can go and buy back my shares from the market. No company shall directly or indirectly purchase its own shares or other securities in case such company has not complied with provisions of section 92, that is filing of annual return, with provisions of section 123 and 127, that is declaration and payment of dividend, provisions of section 129, that is financial statement of the company. So before buying back, all the provisions have to be observed. The auditor must have a knowledge of all these provisions in regard to buyback of shares, who is prohibited to buy back shares, and if you are authorized to buy back shares, whether the authorization is proper or not, and whether all the legal provisions for buying back of shares have been observed or not. So this all is required from the shareholder, from the auditor, to check in the books of accounts with the company. So this was all about the buyback of shares. Now is the preference shares. What are preference shares? They are also owners of the company, but they have got preference over the equity shareholders. Preference in form of dividend. Preference in form of paying back their money at the time of winding up of the company. So, what are the provisions in regard to the preference shares? Issue of preference shares. The explanatory statement annexed to notice of general meeting shall provide complete details of issue of preference shares. Register of members shall contain detail of such preference shareholders. Everything is same, application allotment calls. But the difference is that a separate register is maintained in case of preference shareholders, and the auditor will have to see that entries have been accurately made in the preference shareholders books or not. So the register of members is the document. Then SEBI regulations is another thing which auditor has to observe. If a company is issuing preference shares for a period exceeding 20 years, initially irredeemable preference shares also used to be there, but now not more than 20 years. But if the company is issuing for more than 20 years, it is permitted when? If it is for an infrastructure project. So if the company is issuing preference shares, it has to mention it in the balance sheet that when the preference shares will be redeemed to the shareholders. So all the disclosures has to be made in the balance sheet in regard to the preference shares. Now preference shares has to be redeemed. It can be redeemed at the end of a specified period, or it can be redeemed at the option of the company, or it can be redeemed at the option of the shareholders also. So all these things has to be mentioned in the balance sheet. They shall be redeemed out of the profits which are available for dividends. So what money I can use? I can use free reserves, or I can use money which I collected from issue of new shares. Such new shares, the preference shares which I am going to redeem has to be fully paid up. Partly paid up preference shares I cannot redeem. So the shares has to be fully paid up. Where such shares are redeemed out of profits, when I am using free reserves to redeem, then what happens is we have to create a separate account naming the capital redemption reserve account. Premium payable on redemption, sometimes we redeem with premium also. Then it can be, what can I use is I can use free reserves to pay premium on redemption also. Now a new thing, a new provision. Where a company is not able to redeem any preference shares or to pay dividend on such shares, it may, with consent of holders of 3/4 in value of such preference shares and with approval of tribunal, issue further redeemable preference shares equal to amount due including dividend, and on issue of such further redeemable preference shares, unredeemed preference shares shall be deemed to have been redeemed. Such issue shall not be deemed to an increase or reduction in share capital. I will reissue the, today was the date to redeem all the preference shares, but I was not able to redeem the preference shares. So what I will do is, I will issue, make a further issue of preference shares and issue all these preference shares to the existing holders with new date. Right? It is just like extension of the redemption date. So I want to redeem all the preference shares today, but I'm not having enough money to redeem the preference shares. I will ask the shareholders, and if 3/4 of the preference shareholders agree, what I can do is I can make a further issue of preference shares to these shareholders instead of the existing shares, and the existing shares will get cancelled, and in that case this is not resulting into a increase or decrease in the share. This was all about the preference shares. So today we have read all the provisions in regard to the books of accounts, the financial statements, which includes balance sheet, P&L account, which has to be made as per the schedule 3. Then cash flow statement also is to be included. Apart from that, annual accounts also include auditor's report, which we have done in your chapter number 7. It also includes board's report, which we have read today. Board report will be providing all the details in regard to the state of affairs of the company, any changes in the business, any changes in the subsidiaries, etc. It also includes the director's responsibility statement. So that was a board report. Then we started with the audit of the company. We started with audit of memorandum, articles and prospectus. So an auditor has to have the knowledge of memorandum, articles and prospectus. After that, we started with the share capital.